Simon & Schuster Audio presents Standing for Something, 10 Neglected Virtues That Will Heal Our Hearts and Homes by Gordon B. Hinckley. Read by George Grizzard. With an introduction read by Mike Wallace.
Several years ago, I was taken aback by an unexpected invitation to a luncheon at the Harvard Club in New York City. From prior experience, I figured the food would be mediocre at best. But since I've been asked to break bread with the hitherto mysterious octogenarian president of the Mormon Church, and because the invitation was tendered on the president's behalf by a Jewish-owned public relations firm, it was too tantalizing to pass up. I'd been trying for decades to get some top Mormon leader, any top Mormon leader, to talk to 60 Minutes about himself and his church, and I'd regularly been turned down. Mormon friends of mine had volunteered to put in a good word, and they'd let the Salt Lake City hierarchy understand that an investigation was not what I had in mind, but rather an exploration of what kind of individual led the Mormons. How did he get his job? What about Mormons and polygamy? What about Mormons and black folks? And did the leaders of the Mormon Church really believe that tale about Joseph Smith finding himself anointed at the age of 14 on a farm in upstate New York? Merely the kind of nosy questions we regularly put to all manner of highly placed figures on 60 Minutes. We hardly expected yes for an answer, any more than we'd expected yes for an answer to our similar invitations to the Pope of the Roman Catholic Church. So I was totally unprepared for a cordial, even a sunny greeting from Gordon B. Hinckley at the luncheon. And I was still hesitant when, following his post-prandial remarks, he threw the floor open for questions from any and all of us. Timorously, I wondered aloud to him whether he might entertain the notion of an interview cum profile for 60 Minutes. President Hinckley's bespectacled eyes literally twinkled as he good-naturedly allowed that it sounded like an appealing notion. After all, he really had nothing to hide, and he imagined he'd have little difficulty handling whatever queries I loosed at him. He'd heard and answered worse, he was sure, during his young missionary years in London, where he'd taken on whatever the skeptics and non-believers had thrown at him in his Hyde Park appearances and/or confrontations. So, all the necessary details and arrangements were quickly made. He put at our disposal just about anyone we wanted to talk with from the Salt Lake infrastructure. He put up no objections to our talking to his critics inside and outside the church. He gave us all the camera time we needed. And when we asked for a second sit-down some weeks after the first so that we could put some questions we'd missed in the first go-around, he was perfectly agreeable. It turned out he was as good as his promised word back at the Harvard Club. As a result, we came away with a fascinating profile of a genuinely remarkable man, which confounded more than a few Mormon friends of mine who let me know later how cheery they'd been when they first learned what I'd been up to. Their original take? Hinckley's going to talk to Wallace? Is he dotty? Doesn't he understand what can happen when 60 Minutes sets out to do one of its hatchet jobs? Well, what happened was that my 60 Minutes colleagues and I learned, from the time we spent with Gordon Hinckley and his wife, from his staff, and from other Mormons who talked to us, that this warm and thoughtful and decent and optimistic leader of the Mormon Church fully deserves the almost universal admiration that he gets. I know that may sound more than a trifle corny coming from a dyed-in-the-wool, jaded, New York-based reportorial cynic, but it was difficult not to arrive at that conclusion after talking not only with him but about him, with hard-headed folks like Orrin Hatch and Bill Marriott and Steve Young and Dave Checkets. The last-named individual runs Madison Square Garden in New York and was one of the Mormons who had worried about what could result if President Hinckley laid himself open to our abrasions. Checkets was so surprised when he saw our piece on the air that he told me, I mention this only in the interest of full disclosure, to call him any time I had trouble getting tickets to a fight or a basketball game at the Garden. Further, in the interest of full disclosure, as an 82-year-old myself, Perhaps I can be excused for recalling the exchange I had with President Hinckley near the end of that 60 Minutes profile. Wallace. There are those who say, this is a gerontocracy. This is a church run by old men. Hinckley. Isn't it wonderful to have a man of maturity at the head? A man who isn't blown about by every wind of doctrine? Wallace. Absolutely, as long as he's not dotty. Hinckley. Thank you for the compliment. He is far from dotty. As you listen to this audiobook, you'll find an agile, thoughtful, and engaging mind bent on persuading us to ruminate, along with him, on old-fashioned values by name, virtue, and integrity.
I am a churchman. I readily acknowledge, therefore, that my perspective is a reflection of my upbringing, my training, the virtues and principles in which I believe, and my personal observations as I near age 90. The 20th century was just a decade old when I was born to loving, God-fearing parents. In 1910, a male born in the United States could expect to live to age 50. And I'm happy to say that I have bettered that expectation considerably. In fact, I still feel young, with a love for life and its challenges and pleasures. My life has been rich because it has been filled with problems to solve and associations to savor. I have wrestled with dilemmas large and small. I have known something of discouragement and, on a few occasions, have felt the exhilaration of achievement. I feel a great sense of gratitude for the marvelous and generous blessings of the Almighty. As a result of good health, long life, and various opportunities and obligations arising from responsibilities in the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, which I have the privilege of representing, I have tromped and traveled around this world for the better part of 90 years. I visited more than 150 countries, many of them dozens of times. I love the peoples of the world. I love the sights and smells, the grand varieties of culture with their costumes, customs, and music, eyes dark and light, hair black and blonde, and the incredible range of creativity in everything from architecture to food. I believe this world to be the creation of Jehovah, and I delight in its diversity. But as much as I love the peoples and places of the world, I return from each trip abroad with a peculiar love for my homeland. I love America, for its great and brawny strength, the products of its vital factories, and the science of its laboratories. I love it for the great intellectual capacity of its people, for the generous hearts and helping hands. I love America's tremendous spiritual heritage and strengths. It is unique among the nations of the earth, in its discovery, in its birth as a nation, in the amalgamation of the races and cultures that have come to its shores, in the consistency and strength of its government. My wife and I first visited Jerusalem long ago, before the 1967 war. It was then a divided city. We retained the services of a guide who was an Arab, and during our tour, we stood on an elevation where we could see the other side of Jerusalem. With tears in his eyes, this man pointed to the home from which he had been dispossessed. And then he said with deep emotion, "You belong to the greatest nation on the face of the earth. Yours is the only nation that has been victorious in war and never claimed any territory as a prize of conquest. Your people have given millions, even billions, to the poor of the earth and never asked for anything in return. Rather, even after coming off as conqueror, you have poured yet other billions to revive those who had been your enemies in bloody conflict." I had never thought of this significant perspective before. In no instance during my lifetime did our nation seize and hold territory for itself as a prize of conquest. To the contrary, On a train from Fukuoka on the South Island of Japan to Tokyo, I have passed mile upon mile of great modern steel mills built largely with money from the United States following the devastation of Japan. Now the Japanese are our tremendous competitors in the markets of the world. Not only did we not seize territory at the end of World War II, but we provided the impetus that has led to their superiority in many business enterprises. Surely there is no story like this in all of recorded history. I especially love America for its great spiritual strength. It is a land of churches and synagogues, of temples and tabernacles, of pulpits and altars. We have on our coinage and our currency a national motto. It simply says, "In God we trust." I believe that this is the foundation on which this nation was established, an unequivocal trust in the power of the Almighty to guide and defend us. The hand of the Almighty was manifest on this continent even before the United States of America came into being. I have walked aboard the recreation of the Mayflower, that tiny craft in which 100 men, women, and children crossed the Atlantic in search of freedom, to worship God according to the dictates of their conscience. Before even disembarking from the Mayflower and stepping ashore after their long and grueling voyage, our Pilgrim Fathers drafted and signed the Compact that became the instrument of their governance, the first such document drafted on this continent. It began with these words, "In the name of God, Amen." It went on to say that the signers, by these presents and solemnly and mutually in the presence of God and one another, covenant and combine ourselves together into a civil body politic, and by virtue hereto do enact such just and equal laws as shall be thought most meet and convenient for the general good of the colony. This was the first charter of civil liberty drawn in America, the first of a succession of instruments that became the foundation of the miracle that is America. Consider George Washington, Benjamin Franklin, James Madison, Patrick Henry, Thomas Jefferson, and their associates who signed the Declaration of Independence or participated in the Constitutional Convention. It is my conviction that although we have had a few great leaders since then, there has not been before or since so large a group of talented, able, dedicated, and inherently good men as those whom we call the founding fathers of our nation. For as long as they lived and led, they acknowledged the hand of the Almighty in the affairs of the Republic. Today, we stand on the shoulders of those who preceded us, men and women of courage and conviction who, in the midst of adversity, put their trust in the Almighty and worked endlessly to make their dreams come true, men and women who had nothing to sustain them but hope and faith, but who nonetheless brought to pass the nation that now graces this land. I'm not one to believe that all was good in the long ago and that all is bad today. For many reasons, I proclaim that this is the greatest age the world has known. But there is trouble in the land. Today we face challenges the Founding Fathers could not have possibly imagined or conceived. Our societal challenges would have horrified them. We've come through wars, both civil and international, with victory, and have found peace. Yet now we are a people of contention. Strident and accusatory voices are heard in argument across the nation. We rose from scratch to become the greatest industrial power in the history of the earth, but we've lost some of our competitive edge and have seen other nations move ahead of us in various fields, in both research and production. We spend billions of our resources in litigation against one another. Our spiritual power is sapped by a flood tide of pornography, by a debilitating epidemic of the use of narcotics and drugs that destroy both body and mind, and by a declining moral standard that is alarming and devastating to relationships, families, and the integrity of our nation as a whole. We are forgetting God, whose commandments we have neglected and in some cases forgotten, and which we seem reluctant or too undisciplined to obey.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.